What's up, everybody, and welcome to a brand new episode of the Channel Tracers podcast. As always, I am your host, Jay, and joining me are my good friends and partners in recording crime, Brian and Tony. And no, we are not actually recording crimes, I was just making a turn of phrase. How you doing tonight, boys?
I'm alright. You?
Pretty good, pretty good. Tony?
I'm sassy and ready to go.
All right. Well, that's good because we are going to be talking about a pretty awesome show this week. We are going to be talking about yet another show that we reacted to the trailer of relatively recently, very similar to our Bloodhound episode, which, by the way, thank you to everybody who checked that episode out. We may actually be doing another K-drama coming up soon due to some schedule stuff that came up in terms of what we were originally going to cover, but we'll talk about that more towards the end. So, yeah, we're going to be talking about Kong Skull Island, the animated series on Netflix set in the legendary Monsterverse. So, that's going to be fun. But before we get started with that or any of our other usual segments, we are going to bring a brand new segment into the Channel Chasers podcast. And that segment is Comment Corner, where we read and respond to the comments from you good people over at home on the YouTube channel. Thank you to everybody who's left comments. Really appreciate it. And if you would like to be featured in a future episode of the Channel Tracers podcast, be sure to comment on any of our recent videos, and we'll be sure to have those comments listed down and read them aloud in the next future episode. They don't necessarily have to be just about the show that episode is pertaining to. They could be related to anything that we talk about during screen time, if you guys checked out any of those, any reactions to any of the news stories Brian brings up, any thoughts on the trailers that we talked about in trailer talk, because I'm sure people would like to talk about the One Piece trailer or the abomination that is the Kraven trailer. Fuck you, Brian.
Oh god, that.
Yes, indeed. Fuck you, Brian.
But yeah.
We all said it was only a week.
What we said and what is actually happening are two different things.
Mm-hmm.
Deal with it.
Yes,
anyways.
Deal with it.
Welcome to Comment Corner. Let us begin. So, Tony, you're up first.
This being from our very first video from this new version of the podcast. And this comment comes from Serenity Q saying, "Going Hatless gave me the biggest LOL. LOL. We're back, a YouTuber story. 10 cool points if you get that reference."
What's up, Ricky? And I do indeed get that reference. We're Back, A Dinosaur Story is an underrated animated classic.
Truly a gem.
Oh, yeah.
Of my childhood. Talking dinosaurs? Oh, hell yeah.
Talking dinosaurs that did Broadway song numbers. I was here for that.
Yeah.
Even down to the weird animated moments where maybe question reality.
Oh yeah.
Hello.
But yeah, I'm glad that you seem to be excited that we're back. And I'm glad that going hatless made you laugh. But I do intend to go hatless, although there is going to be a special episode of the podcast where I will be wearing a hat and some other stuff. I'm gonna keep that a surprise. Not even the guys know about this one, but I got something planned.
Ooh.
So, stay tuned for that one.
Curious, but, sir, and curious, sir.
Brian, what is our next comment?
All right, from the Across the Spider-Verse episode, we got a comment from old friend of the show, McDaniel347.
Yep. What's up, Marion? Good to see you.
And they said, "My prediction for what's going to happen to Miguel, even though it's more than likely not going to happen, he is going to lose a fight with either Peter or Miles, and they will tear the spider symbol off his chest and possibly take away his powers and say to him not you're not Spider-Man, and you never will be. If your family could see what you have done and what you have become, they would be ashamed of you. It'll then probably won't want anything to do with you before sending him back to his universe. Upon realizing what happened to him, Miguel will feel angrier than ever and betrayed more, realizing that he brought it all on himself, but that's just me, and more likely it probably won't happen.
So I actually think that's pretty likely. I don't know why he keeps saying that's probably not going to happen. That actually sounds like exactly where it's going.
Yeah, it definitely seems like it to me, but it's wrong because Miguel is the Spider-Man of the future. He's 2099 Spider-Man.
Yeah, I think he was talking more metaphorically of the, you know, you're not Spider-Man and never will be part. That was more of a metaphor of, like, you know, he said that to Miles, but really he's the one acting very un-Spider-Man-like.
Yeah, fair, because in terms of personality, Miguel's the wisecracking level rogue out of costume, and he's very stoic, very business in costume.
Yep.
I don't think it's gonna go that far. Because it seems like Miguel is misguided, but he's doing what he thinks is right.
Oh yeah, that's for sure.
And I think there's gonna be stuff that comes out where we find out more about his motivation and more stuff going on, to where they'll be more sympathetic to him,
mm-hmm.
and then in the end they'll have to team up together to fight Spot.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Need all the help they can get.
Oh, that's for sure. Especially because Spot is now an Eldritch nightmare.
Which, given the fact that he has used that power before, since it's kind of parallel to the Dark Force dimension that Cloak uses. So, yeah.
Yeah, true. Well, yeah, solid theory, Marion. Thank you for the comment. Appreciate it, as always.
Yeah, thanks.
And finally, we have one more comment from Ricky, SerenityQ26. And he says, three episodes in, and I'm loving the series so far. I'll be back when I finish the series. That's great. I'm glad you checked out Bloodhounds, and I'm glad you're enjoying it. You know, it's one that, like, yeah, was a surprising, like, universal score. I'm not gonna spoil it if you pause the video because you didn't want to, you know, hear a spoiler discussion and our final ratings. But I will say it is the rare event in history where the entire panel was unanimous in terms of rating.
Oh yeah.
Yep, it's a miracle.
Oh yeah, because we never agree. Like, all three of us never agree on anything. Like, me and Tony agree sometimes, me and Brian agree sometimes, Tony and Brian agree sometimes, but, like, the three of us together? That's almost a never, like, happens kind of thing. So, definitely looking forward to hearing your thoughts.
A Korean boxing joke.
Right? But yeah, definitely looking forward to hearing your thoughts, Ricky. When you finish up the episode, feel free to comment what you think about it. Either in the comments of that episode again, or, you know, in the comments of this one, if you finish by the time you see this episode. So yeah, that was Comment Corner. Hope you guys enjoyed it. And remember, if you would like to be featured in the next episode, be sure to leave those comments of your thoughts, theories, and feels down below. That way we can feature them up there. I know I keep mentioning the email that, you know, I have Tony put in the description for the Spotify people, but Spotify people, I know, like, emails are very old school nowadays, so if you just want to go to the YouTube video version and leave a comment there, that's also fine. But yeah, we'd love to hear from you. This has been really fun.
Yeah, and we gotta do the email, because the main way that people talk to creators nowadays, we don't have one of those yet.
Yep. I was thinking about it, but you know, the bird website is a cesspool. I don't know if I want to make a second account.
Yeah.
No, not the bird.
Ah.
What do you mean?
The fee.
Oh, Patreon?
Oh.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. I'm in the process of making one of those. Where I'm still debating on whether it be Patreon or Ko-fi, because Ko-fi seems to be better. I'm doing research and weighing the pros and cons. So stay tuned for that, audience. We'll see what we want to do there. I'll talk to the guys off mic, and we'll figure out a situation. If you guys also want to just like directly help us out and donate, because that would be awesome too. But yeah. Now, we're going to go ahead and move on to our next segment. That means we're going to jump right into the news with our boy Brian.
All right, people. So first up, if you know the Geeksphere, you know what's going to happen. But for now, we're going to save that for the last story. The first story is a writer strike update, actually.
All right, what's it? What do we got?
The Screen Actors Guild has failed to reach an agreement for their issue, so looks like they might be joining.
Good!
Oh, hell yeah. You can... just pay people better, Hollywood. God damn it. Just
we kind of talked shit about the actors, about SAG, because of the fact that they wanted to break the solidarity. But now I'm glad that they, you know, they've gotten some sense and, you know, are possibly joining in with the writers.
Indeed. And the Animators Guild has like at least been helping them to like kick it and stuff and join the crowds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because they're technically not the same, but they are.
Yeah, and animators are like the biggest workhorses in the industry. Man, they are super underpaid. I mean, they're not like Japan underpaid, but
let's not get into that.
It's pretty crazy.
I didn't know this, but apparently when you come to somebody like one of the big streaming services or something, and you say, hey, look, I have this project, and you sell them a project that is animated, you can either go to the Screen Actors, to the Screenwriters Guild, or you can go to the Animators Guild, and people want to go to the Writers Guild, but usually the studios say, no, it's the Screen Animators Guild.
Interesting.
Because that costs them less, and the Animators Guild is cheap to pay the people less.
Classic Hollywood cutting corners.
You love
to see it.
That's some classic bullshit right there. Classic bullshit.
Yep. And one other side effect that is now because of the writer strike, Comic-Con is taking a massive hit. San Diego.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
To be fair, when hasn't San Diego Comic-Con taking like the fattest of L's?
That's not entirely true. The only time they've really taken a fat L was how poorly they handled their remote show during the pandemic.
I'm being hyperbolic. I apologize.
Yeah, but this one's going to be bad because it was already announced that Sony, Disney, Marvel, Lucasfilms, Netflix, HBO, and Universal are all skipping.
Damn, Hall H is gonna be a fucking ghost town.
Yup.
The reasoning has to be so fucking stupid.
No, it's the writer's strike. Like, they can't speak about projects they're writing because nothing's being written.
Fair enough. Yeah, you're right.
Yep, and they've already announced that the Marvel slate of films have been pushed back.
Yep, so they don't. So because of that, they probably just have nothing to show. So there's no point in using their resources to show up to an event when you have nothing to promo.
Yeah, fair enough. Worse enough.
Yep.
Not with the pants down, so to speak, when you can't, give people a fair wage.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now let's move on to something that's a little bit, like, sunset-y, like, bright after the dark type news, because it was actually officially announced that we knew a while back, because we've covered this before, that Justin Roiland got taken off of all of his stuff, Rick and Morty, Solar Opposites, all of that.
Yep, yep. So,
recently it was announced who is replacing him on Solar Opposites.
Okay.
None other than Legion himself, Dan Stevens.
Oh, cool. Nice. Dan Stevens is dope. He also was very good in a lot of other things I've seen him in. I can't think of them off the top of my head, but I've seen him in a bunch of stuff. He's very good. He's yeah. a really good actor. I believe he was in that shitty Beauty and the Beast. I think he was the... Right? Wasn't he? He was in that, wasn't he? I'm pretty sure he was. I think he was the Beast.
I don't remember.
Yeah, no, he was the Beast. Yeah. The original solo song they had was for him, like the Nevermore or whatever the fuck was called. That was actually a bright spot in an otherwise shitty movie.
Facts. The music in that live action Disney remake saved a very fucking disappointing remake.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
My favorite Disney film in live action gave it the worst singing lead this side of the universe. Sorry, Emma.
Nah, it's okay. I'm sure Emma understands.
You burned a bridge just a little bit with me here, Disney. I know you did it for money, but still, you've turned out banging songs. How does the moment last forever and Nevermore? Good songs.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and speaking about doing things for money, gentlemen, it's time to get a little sus up in here. CBS Studios has announced that they are adapting the popular video game Among Us into an animated series.
What the fuck?
Oh, good lord.
This feels like one of those committee old people, like, what do the kids like there, Johnson? This Among Us? Alright, can we buy that? Can we make that a thing? Kids like them cartoons still, right? Let's make it one of them cartoons.
Now, there is one bright spot to it, because they announced already who the creator and showrunner is going to be.
Okay.
And that is none other than Owen Dennis, which that name might not sound familiar, but his most popular project might. He was the creator and showrunner of Infinity Train.
Oh, shit! Infinity Train is amazing!
Okay. But, gentlemen, has Among Us been relevant since, what was it?
2020, 2019, the era where people do still play it. Watch it. If you go back to my Twitch channel, we played it a lot, and Tony was the worst imposter ever.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like, can we gauge popularity in a, like, the cultural
zeitgeist? I mean, it's still in the cultural zeitgeist, because there's still a lot of, like, Among Us memes. The memes are still very strong.
Memes are always going to be strong and prevalent, Jay, regardless of words.
That's not entirely true. My favorite meme format is dead. The sassy cat pointing at the lady. That one's gone.
I'm sure I've seen a few memes of like that sassy cat. Still around.
But anyway, with the creator. With the creator, it seems like there might be some hope.
I mean, yeah, it all depends on the direction they go. If they go for like a comedy spin where like, you know, they literally kind of like go in a sort of direction that the D&D movie went, where the dialogue and stuff feels like the shit talking that you get in an Among Us game with your friends. And, like, the lies and, like, oh, no, you saw me doing lasers. You know, you saw I was in medical. Shit like that. Or, you know, show the absolute death zone that is electrical. Y'all remember electrical. Electrical is where everyone goes to die.
And stuff like, bitch, what? Why are you lying out your ass? You saw me. I was right fucking there.
I still remember the one time Brian actually won a game because he turned one of our friends on each other because they were accusing each other. He just shut up. And me and my friend Jordan were just sitting there in ghost chat like, oh, this motherfucker's actually gonna get away with this. I can't believe this is happening.
Yeah,
you were.
Yep, and I played right into it.
Evil, yep. Clever bastard.
Yeah, no, good times. Good times.
Evil. Yep, I can even remember. I forgot which one of them it was, but I had a clear chance to kill one of them, and I was like, nope. Keep the feud going.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, if they do shit like that, I think it has the potential to actually be a good show. But as of right now, I'm just kind of scratching my head on this one.
Exactly. So, gentlemen, it's time to talk about the big news.
Oh, you mean a certain bird? Or is it a plane? I don't know.
Nah, it's Superman. We have the casting for Superman and Lois for James Gunn's Superman Legacy.
I gotta say, I'm excited for this.
Yep, me too. We have David...
Cornsweet,
which big Ryan Murphy actor. He was in The Politician, but...
Yep, he was the lead actor for The Politician. He played River, for those of you guys who are curious. Yeah.
I thought Ben Platt was the lead.
Was it Ben Platt who played River? Oh, wait, no, River was the boyfriend. No, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, River was the other hot guy. Ben Platt was the main dude. Never mind. You're right.
David was the lead in a different Ryan Murphy show that we actually covered in the podcast archive.
Oh, cool. Hollywood. Oh! Oh, dude, that was a good show. Was he the one who played the in the closet actor?
He was the lead.
Yeah. Okay. Cool.
So, tell me, Brian, who's the actor playing Clark?
David Cornsweet.
I had a funny joke, but I lost it.
When I saw his name, I knew his name, but like every time I read it, I get a good laugh because it's just like that sounds like a made up last name.
Yeah, it does. Corn sweat. Those things don't sweat, you silly goose.
All right, so the Lois caster.
Lois, you might have to help me with this name too, Jay. If you know it.
All right. Oh, Rachel Brosnahan, I think is how it's said.
Brosnahan. Yes.
She is fantastic. And this was the casting that got me the most excited because I love the marvelous Mrs. Maisel. I talked about it on Screen Time. The show is over. We can't cover it now because it was a 5-season show and I don't want to put these boys through 5 seasons. But... it was an amazing show. Tony Shalhoub did an amazing job as her dad. But, like, dude, it was awesome. She has the energy, the sass, the fucking go-getter attitude that you would expect from a Lois Lane. And you know, the guy who played River in The Politician, David Cornsweet, you can tell from Hollywood that he has this, like, very strapping action hero figure, but he can play the down-to-earth farm boy that, you know, you would expect from Clark. So I'm very excited for both these castings.
Yep, I've seen like 2 or 3 seasons of Miss Maisel, I think, and I completely agree, she's perfect. And like you said, with Hollywood, it was like, we got to see parts of him, and so we know that he was this big, muscular dude who actually served in the military in the show,
mm-hmm.
and we saw a bit of that. But also, he could be a very unique character.
So, Tony, if you're curious, Hollywood is this, like, alt future, 1930s Hollywood. And he played, I believe it was Clark Gable?
Oh, so it's like a look at the golden age of Hollywood.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. It's an alt history version where, you know, gays were accepted in the 30s.
Oh, okay.
Where he actually got to come out and, you know, be loved for who he is.
That's interesting.
He played a dude who was former soldier, who dreamed about being a Hollywood star, but couldn't make it, and then found his way to a gas station that provided other
special services.
Special services.
Special services. Yes. The kind the guys, you know, knock on bathroom stalls for.
Oh.
Yeah, you know, particular congressmen.
Can't really mention.
Oh my. Well, you gotta do what you gotta do, I guess.
I mean, especially in the 1930s.
Oh boy.
But minor spoiler, we do follow his like trying to rise to stardom, and
we see him change his name to Clark Gable.
Okay. I will have to look into this because I find Hollywood back in that time to be a very fascinating.
It's really cool.
It really is.
It's really cool, and it has this like almost utopian look at the end, because like when me and Brian were watching it, and you know, we mentioned this in the episode that we got covered for the podcast, but we thought it was going to go the realistic angle where, like, you know, he ends up like dead and alone, and like, you know, it just ends up real sad. But like it has a very triumphant, happy ending, and like, you know, representation is actually fought for very early, like in the 30s. So I was just like, oh, so they're going like an if Hollywood was better angle.
Yeah, I mean, doesn't always have to follow certain things as long as it's feasible.
Oh yeah, no, it wasn't like it didn't like break immersion or anything. It just kind of, you know, surprised us, because we were, because mm-hmm. the whole time prior to this, it was a very realistic showing the dark underbelly of, you know, gangster run 1930s Hollywood.
Okay, yeah, but it's kind of well, Jay, now that I think about it.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
That's why you like Oshinoko so much.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Which, shameless plug, shameless.
Oh, don't worry. I'm gonna plug it during screen time. Don't you worry about that. But yeah, continue, Brian.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that to end things off. Yeah, and Hollywood, if people hadn't seen it, like Tony, is really good. It's one of those things. Well, first of all, just a quick side note. It also features Jay's favorite trope, like in TV. The blonde bitch with a heart of gold.
Oh yeah, hell yeah, dude! That is my favorite TV trope. The bitch with the heart of gold, and somehow it's almost always a blonde.
Typically,
yeah, and also, unlike other Ryan Murphy stuff, it's clear he had a goal for one season, did it and was done with it, didn't try to franchise it, didn't try to like do
also,
more with it, ruin a good thing.
Also, it is an acting tour de force. My God, the performances in this show are phenomenal.
Definitely will have to give that a look. Oh, but
yeah, it's on Netflix. Definitely check it out.
Okay. Hey,
yep.
Brian, have you heard of this little nugget of information that I found absolutely amusing? And I think Jay might get a kick out of this too.
Okay, what is it?
Guess what Warner Bros. Has been doing lately.
Oh, yeah, you told me about this off mic. Go ahead.
It is so hilarious. Warner Bros., in an attempt to get people into seats, are giving tickets to The Flash for free.
Yeah, they've shown like a bunch of free early screenings, and like they've been giving away press passes for the movie just so people will go fucking see this absolute train wreck.
Yeah, it is hysterical.
Which, by the way, people at home, I would like to amend my statement prior. I just think we're not going to cover this movie at all. After what I've heard about the cameos, especially the whole George Reeves situation, no way in hell. No way in hell.
Okay, all right. But actually, Tony, you did remind me of something that I meant to say. It's like an amendum to the last story.
Oh, really?
And that's the fact that people theorize why they decided to do the announcement of Superman and Lois like this and not do like a big fanfare like Marvel usually does.
To get the heat? To get the heat off of The Flash?
Yup.
Makes sense. Good strategy. It worked.
For the most part. Reports are saying that they're looking to lose $200 million from the film.
Yep. It looked pretty expensive.
Yep.
Yep, and a lot of actors, even ones that you wouldn't even expect, like Tom Cruise, came out and gave it tons of praise, but still
he was probably paid. They probably gave a nice fat donation to the Church of Scientology. So yeah. Tom Cruise was like, alright.
More than likely.
Probably. Also, apparently. Sorry.
It's all good. All I was about to say was, do y'all know that Secret Invasion is out right now?
Yeah, I heard. Did they, like, was it, like, leaked? Or, like, is it out?
It's out.
Out.
Oh, shit.
Two episodes.
I didn't know. Because, like, I saw news about it. I saw a thumbnail for, like, a spoiler review. I thought that was just, like, a press screening. Like, I saw it early, so here's my video.
Nah.
Oh, shit.
It's like 6 or 8 episodes, so we can cover it soon.
I think they said
that's hype.
Episode series. And from what I understand, because I'll be doing a bit of catch up on it myself, it looks like it's going to be an interesting tour de force.
I mean, that trailer for it looked amazing, so I'm super hyped.
Yeah.
Apparently,
indeed.
I'm just curious, but yeah, that's all I had to say just to remind the fellows of something I found hilariously funny.
Oh yeah, for sure.
The newsosphere.
It's just the last thing about The Flash is apparently they showed a pre-screening of it at, I think it was CinemaCon this last year, and they had the effects, and they said that the finish of the movie wasn't finished yet, so everybody thought that all the effects that were in it were just because they weren't done.
Yeah.
Yet apparently most of the effects still stayed the same from the screening.
So my brother watched The Flash. Hilarious. And you know what he told me, Brian? Hilarious. He told me that the effects for Barry in the movie were worse than the effects for Barry in the TV show.
Oh, damn.
And we know, look, I reviewed The Flash for years. One of my complaints from season 3 onwards was how lazy they got with the animations that I literally learned how to make in Adobe After Effects. If you remember, I used to do little like special intros and outros for like the season finales for those shits, and I'd put like the running effect on. So if my self-taught ass can do that with a $200 program.
Yeah.
What does that say about this fucking movie?
I don't know, dude. But maybe we'll do a screen time on it when one of us.
Maybe. I might bite the bullet out of curiosity.
But when it eventually comes to Max, because it will. But anyway, that's it for news. Went a little long there, but we had a big story.
Ah, that's fine. All right. So now we're going to go into trailer talk, the section of the show where Brian gives us a curated list of trailers that we are going to react to off camera, then quickly return and give you our rapid fire thoughts on said trailers. So Brian, tell the folks at home what trailers we will be reacting to tonight. And also remember, I will be leaving a link to the playlist for you guys to watch for yourselves in the description down below. So if you want to pause the video right here, click that playlist and then, you know, react along with us, go ahead. But Brian, what trailers are we covering tonight?
Yes, what do you have for us, you crazy goober?
I'm not a fucking boomer.
He said goober.
I said goober.
Okay.
God damn.
Well, that's what happens when you don't speak up.
Actually, I heard him perfectly clear, so I'm not going to let you get away with that one.
Anyway, moving on. We're starting with one of the big trailers of the week, Challengers, which, if you haven't heard about it, is, they say, a possible run for Oscar for Zendaya.
Is this Challengers of the Unknown? Or is...
Nope.
Oh, see. Well, my nerd hype died. I was like, they're actually making a movie for Challengers of the Unknown? I thought I was the only person who remembered this.
Is this the Challenger like shuttles?
No. But dude, this will hit another thing for you, Jay. Your fan thing is off.
Okay.
Your messy side, because
it's about a very
messy love triangle within the tennis world with Zendaya and two guys.
Is that the trailer that went viral on Twitter of her like having a three-way? I saw a clip of the three-way on Twitter. I didn't watch the trailer, but I was wondering where this is from. Because while I was on vacation, like yesterday, we were in the hotel and we were talking about like movies and shit. And they're like, you know, Zendaya's hoeing herself out. She's out here fucking on screen now. I'm like, wait, what? Get to see Zendaya fuck.
Okay, so full disclosure, I didn't realize it was Zendaya throughout the entire thing. I was so enraptured, like, what the fuck am I watching?
Interesting. Now I really want to see this trailer. I'm excited.
Yeah. And also, you see why he didn't recognize her, because there's a reason.
Interesting.
And I'll leave that. And then a movie called Driveaway Dolls, which I never heard about till now. But it's gonna be a road trip movie with two relatively unknown actresses, but Pedro Pascal is in it in a supporting role.
Is he a dad? He's gotta be the dad. He's gonna be somebody's dad.
No, I think it's going back to his Narcos days, I believe.
Oh!
Okay.
But also, it's directed by one half of the Coen brothers.
Okay. Oh, cool. Only one Coen brother. Interesting.
Let's be fair, Jay. We know for a fact that Pedro Pascal is just going to be called Daddy. You and I both know.
I mean, he's got some major daddy energy. I'm not going to hold you.
I am not disagreeing here. Do you see any disagreement on my face?
No, none at all.
Exactly.
But next up, we've got Elio, which is Pixar's next thing, about a boy who makes first contact with aliens.
Cool.
Okay.
It's probably going to make us cry like all Pixar movies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Then Survival of the Thickest, which is an upcoming Netflix show.
Excuse me?
A female stand-up comedian.
Oh. See, I had a whole nother vision in my head, and I could tell Tony was having a similar vision, and that vision just died. Damn.
I heard that vision. But next up, from that. Oh,
see, this is the stuff you're missing out on, audio people, because you heard the oh, but you didn't see Tony and I like simultaneously eyebrow raise, like, what? You're missing out. And watch the video version.
Comedy gold, right there.
Yeah. Then a Celebrity, which is an upcoming Netflix K-drama about a woman's rise to stardom and all the trouble that comes from it.
Oh, that sounds fun.
Okay.
That sounds real interesting.
Okay, let's keep our eyes and ears on it.
And look, K-dramas have been doing pretty good for us, so you never know.
Yep. And then a J-drama called Burn the House Down, also by Netflix.
Ooh.
So, what's with that one, Brian?
It looks like it's gonna be like a stalker mystery type thing, from what I saw.
That sounds intriguing.
Okay.
Then, switching up to a completely different thing, but also Netflix, Captain Vol.
What's that?
It's an animated show about a dude who longs to be the captain of his own boat and finally gets that dream, only to find out that he's been set up to be the fall guy of a drug organization that is transporting drugs on said ship.
Oof. That's a raw fucking deal.
That sounds hilarious, yeah. Honestly.
And it's got a spreading of a bunch of familiar faces, including Christopher Maloney from Law and Order, but also Harley Quinn.
Yep.
All right.
And then another DC actor, Mazikeen from Lucifer.
Oh, shit. I love her. She's hot. Okay.
And our lead, which is perfectly casted for a like person who's like a dupe, Jason Ritter.
Oh, man.
A.K.A. Dipper Pines.
That's just great.
Yep.
Yep. And then lastly, I thought we'd do something a little bit different, which harkens back to the origins of Jay's first channel.
All right.
And that is Marvel has released a trailer for the upcoming comic event called Fall of X, and I thought we'd give that a watch.
Okay, cool. That's definitely different. I like it. Okay. I'm down.
If I have to hazard a guess, they're killing off the X-Men again.
Oh, also, just real quick side tangent for any of you comic nerds out there listening. Did you guys hear that they're bringing the Ultimate Universe back? And it's going to be run by Jonathan fucking Hickman?
Yeah. I actually heard that there's this event going on right now called Ultimate Invasion.
Yeah.
It's fascinating.
I am excited. Jonathan Hickman doing the Ultimate Universe? Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
But this could have interesting ramifications now that you think about it.
Oh, yeah. And they could finally give Miles his own fucking, you know, place where he's not just a second banana to Peter Parker.
Or would that even happen exactly?
You never know. We'll see. But yeah.
Because now he's probably feeling the tug of two different worlds.
Maybe. But yeah, we'll see. Those are some good trailers. I'm excited to, you know, see what they're about. So, folks, pause the video, check out that playlist, watch those trailers for yourself, and then we'll be back momentarily with our rapid fire thoughts. We will see you guys shortly after this word from the sponsors that we do not have. And we're back. Welcome back, everybody. So, we have some trailers to discuss. What did you guys think of this batch of trailers?
Entertaining as fuck. So, let's get the rundown. Let's start with Brian. Brian, what's that standout trailer for you, in your honest opinion?
Well, honestly, I think the best one is the one that I regrettably have already seen. Which was the Champions trailer.
Oh, the Challengers?
Yeah.
Champions.
Challengers. That was a saucy trailer. Yeah. I'm leaving that in, by the way. I'm going to leave it in just because.
All right, good.
That was.
But yeah, Challengers.
That was definitely a saucy trailer.
Oh, yeah. When I first saw it, I was like, oh, well, hello. What are you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And, you know, like, right after that, I would have to say it's that Disney Pixar film. It was pretty entertaining.
Oh, yeah. That looks fun. It had a lot of good humor in it. I want to see what part's going to make me cry.
Yeah.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, he's being raised by a single mother who we saw in that brief second. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe the single mother is played by Gina Rodriguez.
Oh, cool.
Okay, and it looks like she's in the military, so that's interesting.
Yeah, so it's on some, like, Area 51 type shit.
Mm-hmm. And you know what? I gotta give it to Captain Fall. I really want to see what they're going on with that. But
Captain Fall looks funny. Probably the standout trailer for me was Celebrity.
Oh, yeah.
And I am
the biggest surprise.
Very intrigued. That had a super interesting twist that was revealed in the trailer. Not gonna talk about it, because, like, we are probably gonna cover this on the podcast very soon. Some slots have opened up recently. We'll talk about that more towards the end. But yeah.
Jake looks great as well.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Burn the house down. Also a very intriguing premise.
Yeah, I'm really curious to know what's going on with that. Drive Away Dolls? I'm very curious to see what's going on with that.
Oh yeah, that looks like a very fun movie. It looks very much like, it gives me Thelma and Louise meets Fargo.
Yeah.
To be honest, it feels very Tarantino-esque, if you catch my drift.
Oh yeah, but I mean, it also just feels like a Coen Brothers movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, true.
Oh yeah, for
even
sure.
If it's just Coen Brother.
Yeah, it's just...
Yeah.
And
also, even though it sparked, sorry,
it's okay. I mean, getting a sad cast and all this crazy stuff, it's bound to be good.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Oh yeah, especially Man of the Hour, Pedro Pascal.
Everybody's favorite dad.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Or daddy, or both.
Or both.
Both is good. I mean, he's called Daddy, so...
If he fully embraces it, it's hilarious.
Oh, fuck yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
Have you seen those compilations of that man just talking about his illicit drug usage? God,
oh, yeah, it's really funny.
Mm-hmm. He even said in an interview, like, in a late-night talk show... That when he got the announcement that he was going to be Joel, he then like took an Ambien or something and thought the whole thing was a dream when he got accepted.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh, hell yeah. It's like one of our favorite stories from a friend of ours named Steve. Steve, if you're out there in the ether, man, we miss you, buddy.
We miss you, man.
Oh, yeah, Steve.
He loves sharing this story. So for those of you who don't know, comics writer Grant Morrison is a very unique individual.
Oh, I know the story he's talking about. Oh, this is a fun one. I'll let this one go.
So, in summation, you could say that Grant Morrison is trying to make breakthroughs while being high as fuck wearing a towel on his head.
Like a swami. He specifically mentioned in the story, like a swami.
Like a swami, yes. And let's be honest here, folks. Our boy Steve may not be the most, what's the word we're looking for?
Personable?
Yeah. Personable. He tells it like it is.
Oh yeah, no, he's very blunt. Oh man, I still, Steve, if you're out there, I miss your bread lady stories. Tony, you remember his story?
I remember my bread ladies.
Yep.
I remember.
Oh god,
his work stories were fucking gold.
Dude, it made me think like, man, grocery stores are crazy places. Because he would tell us all these shenanigans that would happen at the grocery store he worked at the time. Seriously, though, Steve, we miss you, buddy. If you somehow come across this video, you know, hit us up sometime.
Yeah.
And one of the things that we used to talk about with Steve is comic books, which, speaking of...
Oh, yeah, that trailer.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yep.
It looks really interesting. There's a lot of shit going on. Tony marrying Emma Frost. Diamond Pussy, man. I'm not mad at you.
Yeah. We
Kurt Wagner as the Spider-Man.
Right?
He's flexible enough to do so. I mean, that prehensile tail. Hello.
And he already does kind of walk on walls, because he does that with his, like, you know, like, are they considered webbed, but like his weird feet?
His weird demon hands and feet?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're not technically webbed.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know what you technically call those, but yeah.
Demon feet. Let's call, just go.
It's definitely a cool design for sure. I'm curious to see how that goes.
And bringing back like somewhat forgotten teams like Alpha Force.
Oh yeah, Alpha Flight, which was like relegated to being Carol Danvers' flunkies for a little bit.
Oh god, I felt bad for that super team. They're Canada's premier super team. Why would you do them dirty like that?
Apparently people at Marvel just hate Canada. Sorry, our Canadian friends out there.
Blame Canada.
We're not moms against Canada, okay, folks?
I mean, look, I love America's hat. All right.
Indeed.
Perfect snow cap. Come on, now.
And... you know, they've made some of my favorite TV shows of all time. I am still a hardcore Degrassi fan.
And they also gave us some of our favorite people. Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah, Ryan Hello? Reynolds. Our good friend Mayumi over on Twitch. She's
Robin
one...
Robin Scherbatsky or
Yeah,
something?
Robin Scherbatsky.
Yeah.
Even if Robin pissed me off in later seasons.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, but that's kind of the show. Everybody pissed me off.
Fair enough.
Everybody pissed me off the entire show.
but okay,
it also, here's something very interesting that from this whole trailer, the whole shenaniganery, is the villains in that are all the tech-based supervillains. And I mentioned this while we were watching, like a little after.
Yeah.
And Brian was just out. I wanted
his
thoughts on it. Because we see, like, fucking MODOK in his 24 head.
Yeah.
I'm glad they didn't adopt MODOK's MCU design.
And he's not with AIM. He's with ORCID?
Yeah, so I can kind of explain Orchid for a quick TLDR. Orchid is this evil technological conglomerate that is directly going against Beast, who on his end of things is doing a bunch of shady shit with technology, including mind controlling an entire country with a sentient plant virus.
God damn, Hank, what the fuck?
Yeah,
man?
Hank has gone mad with power, and he's been he's like just straight up evil now. And so the villains are like, well, you're not gonna cut us in on this technology pie here. You're gonna hoard all this awesome tech for yourself just so you can get your autonomy as a nation or whatever. Well, we're gonna steal this shit. So that's what they're doing.
Also, I don't know why, but Tony suit now incorporates Sentinel technology.
Yeah, curious.
I wonder,
even though he's marrying a mutant.
Yeah. I wonder if that helps him smash.
Probably.
I mean,
I wouldn't put it past Tony. Would not put it past Tony.
I mean, if you want to fucking drill for diamonds, you fucking drill for diamonds, there, Tony. You do you, buddy.
Yeah. I was going to make another joke, but I feel like, you know, if we want monetization in the future, I should not make it. So I'm just going to leave it alone.
And I think the closest we can get without demonetization was what Tony said.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I think that's the safest bet.
For sure. But that was trailer talk. Definitely, if you guys have any particular thoughts on any of those trailers that are in the playlist, feel free to leave them in the comments down below and you'll get featured in the next comment corner.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's time.
Alright, folks, this is the segment of the podcast where we all go through bits of media that we have consumed in between podcast episodes that can range from everything between books, manga, TV shows, anime, movies, and so much more. So I'm going to kick it off with a plug for something that is coming up, and if you're watching this video, should already be out by then. We actually, and by we I mean Tony and myself, just did our first episode of Channel Chaser's Mini Weeb Edition. And in this first episode, we covered Oshinoko Season 1, which just wrapped up as of recording this podcast episode. And boy, was it a fantastic season. You will see our scores and deeper thoughts in the video itself, so I'm not really going to go into it here. We don't actually spoil anything for that show in that video. It was all just kind of positive praise of what the show does well without actually diving deep into the plot. So it's safe for anybody who just wants to see if the show is worth watching.
And I gotta say, personally, we started off our rating with Weeb Edition very strong.
Yeah, and honestly, guys, like, the thing that surprised me the most, especially because it was me and Tony that were involved in the video, we stayed on track the entire time. I did not have to edit out tangents.
Wow.
The entire time, my people.
It's a 26-minute video, so it is chunky for a review, but trust me, it could have easily been an hour long.
It's spoilers, of course. It's spoilers, granted.
Oh yeah, for sure. But yeah, other stuff that I have been consuming, I finished two audiobooks. I finished the Thrawn Alliances audiobook that I got with my credit from this past month, the sequel to the first Thrawn novel that I talked about previously in Screen Time episodes that I was reading. And I literally got through this one in two sittings because it was just that good. This was a direct follow-up to the first Thrawn book. This takes place a few years later, and this actually takes place kind of in the middle of the Star Wars Rebels era. Because he references the fact that, you know, he took on Kanan Jarrus and the Phoenix Squadron, and they manage to escape. He references the episode with the Bendu and stuff like that. So that stuff has already happened. And in this novel, basically, Thrawn and Vader are teamed up together by the Emperor to deal with a particular threat. And we get to see both, like, Thrawn and Vader's current interactions and Thrawn and Vader when they first met, when Thrawn was Anakin. And we actually get to see, like, Thrawn piecing together, this guy acts very familiar. And so, like, him actually piecing together the secret that Vader is Skywalker is a big part of it. It's really cool. The characterization of Vader is amazing. It's a great book. Highly recommend it. Go check it out.
Nice.
The other thing that I also would highly recommend connects to another show that we praise highly on the podcast before as well, and that is Chapter 3, or Part 3, of the Audible Sandman audio drama. The final portion of the story that covers, I think, the last 6 volumes of the series. My God, this is phenomenal. I've loved it from the start. You know, I can't praise it enough. The voice cast they got for this radio play podcast was absolutely amazing. They got freaking, you know, James McAvoy as Morpheus. Phenomenal. Kat Dennings actually makes an amazing death. She brings all this bubbly, vibrant energy that, you know, you would expect from death. Desire is very good as well. You know, all the Endless are pretty awesome. The actor who voices Old Hob is really cool. It's a really great radio play, and if you love the comics or you don't have time to collect all the comics, this is a great way to consume Sandman, because it literally is just them voicing out the comics. So it's a lot of fun. The music is really great. Would highly recommend it if you have an Audible subscription. Audible, we all use your service. I'm gonna keep saying it. Look, we're here, we're ready. Just tell us, and, you know, we will make a code and everything. We will plug the hell out of you. You're already getting a lot of free advertisement from me in screen time. So hit us up. So the other things that I have watched in between podcast episodes, I watched 3 movies, 2 of which were movies that my dad recommended that feature our boy, the God of Thunder himself, Mr. Chris Hemsworth. The 2 Extraction movies, which are these, like, military ops movies that are on Netflix. Both of them are awesome. He does a great job in them. It was a lot of fun watching those. And the other movie I checked out, in direct reference to this show, because I hadn't seen it yet, and I found out it was on HBO Max, I watched Godzilla vs. Kong. Which was very fun.
Nice. I was meaning to watch that.
So I'm the only one who actually watched it when it came out at the time.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I gotta say this. As someone who loves his kaiju movies, I really enjoyed this. I enjoyed Legendary Pictures, Godzilla vs. Kong. It was such a fun
film. Yeah.
I mean, it's not as fun as Godzilla vs. Kong, the Toei version, made back in, like, the 60s.
Oh, that was awesome.
That shit is hilarious. And it's relevant to what we're going to be talking about.
It's 2 motherfuckers in rubber suits just going at it.
No. I'm talking about just... in that movie... Kong fights a fucking giant octopus. That was
He does. That's right.
And that octopus, that green screen effect. I mean, it was back in the 60s and 70s. It was poor then.
Yeah.
And it's poor now, but it's great regardless of how bad it looks. It's perfect. Which leads us to something we will be talking about when we talk about Skull Island proper.
For sure. But Brian, what pieces of media have you been consuming in between podcast episodes?
Okay, so first of all, I finished Lower Decks, the Star Trek animated show. It was really good. I was wrong last week when I described it because it's about a different even class of ship from like Star Trek, so it's not even like the Orville. It's like the Orville when you hear about like the other lower ships that they talk about but never really show. This is about the California class ship where they deal with second contact, like delivering on promised goods, making peace treaties.
That's actually pretty interesting. Like in terms of like a world building kind of setup.
Definitely.
It is. And the lead of the ship is the lead for like normal people that you'd see in Star Trek are the captain who is voiced by what's his name's wife on Futurama.
Hermes' wife.
Hermes.
Yep, Hermes, sorry. I brain farted. And then her number one is Jerry O'Connell, who some old school people might know him from Sliders, but more recently he's known for a while there. He was the Superman in the animated universe movies when they were all connected. Like
yeah, when it was the New 52 stuff, yeah.
Yeah, he was their Superman. He did a pretty good job.
He did.
Here he's more of a gym rat dude bro, but like played up for laughs. And then her chief medical officer, who is a catfolk woman.
Okay.
And she's not played up sexy. She actually curses like a sailor. Like, get the fuck out of my way. What the fuck are you doing? And all of that. But also, since the show has a certain rating, they bleep most of it.
And sometimes
she'll just go on tirades where she gets angry and she's like, bleep, 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 son of a bleep, 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 to the bleep, bleep.
Nice.
And then they have their tactical officer, who is a male Bajoran, if you know what that means, but voiced by Fred Tatasciore.
Oh, cool. Hulk.
Yep. He's a big, beefy dude with gray hair who always is like violence first, but has like that heart of gold type personality. You know, stuff that Fred Tatasciore is known for, but
so Hulk.
Dialed up to the nth.
Like me punchy, but also, how is your wife today?
Yes, and also me punch, but me also get out all of my emotions by doing pottery.
Okay. Interesting. I bet the Hulk could make some pretty great pottery.
It's a good hobby.
But yeah, that's the main crew of the ship. And though they are cast members of the show, they're like secondary characters.
Okay.
Where we follow the main crew, which is, they're all ensigns. Like, the lower tier.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know how they all have stars?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Captain is four stars. They're one stars. So,
I can't help but chuckle at that, because I play a lot of gacha games, and I'm just one stars.
Right. But yeah, you have your cocky, run off the cuff, Kirk type woman who's a badass, but loves breaking rules. And the only reason why she's still in Starfleet is because her parents work for Starfleet.
Ah, a Nepo baby.
Nepotism.
Yeah, yeah. And then you've got the studious, wannabe, nerdy, wants to rise up the ranks. And this is the one that is so voiced by Jack Quaid.
So are they the ass? Is Huey the ass kisser?
The boys.
Probably.
Yep. And Ensign Boimler. Brad Boimler.
That is.
That's his name.
Nerd ass name I have ever heard in my life. Boimler.
I want to give that dude a wedgie.
I am a pale as fuck, part ginger white boy. I want to give that motherfucker an atomic wedgie.
And then there's Tendi, who is the secondary lead female, who is the medical ensign. But she's actually the race Orion, which is the same as the classic green lady that we mentioned before with Kirk.
Ah, okay.
But she wants to, like, live past the stereotypes of her race. And
of being sexy, scantily clad. So is she like a hello nurse type?
No, but she is a badass who is funny and also nerdy.
I'm just saying, because hello nurse, if you guys don't remember from her actual song in Animaniacs, she has a full-on PhD and is pretty hilarious.
Oh yeah.
Well, also the thing is. Sorry.
No, you're fine. I was done.
Good, bro. Oh, good.
The thing is, in the Star Trek world, Orions are known for being the sexy, but they're also known for being just infamous space pirates. And all they do is plunge and pillage. So
they just want that booty.
So she's kind of a little bit against that, but she like has the classic story arc of learning to embrace that side of her somewhat.
Ah, okay.
And then the last one is the engineer ensign, who is Rutherford, voiced by Casey from Loki.
Oh, cool.
Interesting.
And he's a cyborg, but he's not like full on Geordi where it's like all over his eyes. He just has one eye. Where there's a screen above it. Kind of like a Dragon Ball counter that's infused to his head.
Oh, so he has a scouter.
He has a scouter over which eye, right or left?
I think his right.
Interesting.
Okay.
But anyway, it glitches and messes up all the time.
I've always wanted a scouter.
There's one episode where it keeps having an error stream. And he keeps, like, walking into walls.
Ooh, that poor fuck.
That sucks.
Fuck. But those four are our leads. So sometimes the main, like, captain and her people will go off and have, like, this big, giant adventure while we're following these guys. And so it's just, like, the off-the-story B-plot.
Ah, okay.
So, like, main series is... You guys are just the B-plot in every A-plot episode for us, you know. It's
kind of.
Interesting.
Kind of. But yeah, it's really cool and embraces a lot of tropes and a lot of things of Star Trek. Like I mentioned, I didn't mention this. It has a lot of cameos, too. Like, one of my favorites is Riker shows up.
Does he do the pose?
Oh my god.
Yes.
Hell yeah.
Oh, of course, he had to do the pose.
This is Captain Riker, where he's like full on let to do his own thing.
Nice.
Like actual captain. All right.
Yeah, but then there's also other cameos too. Q pops up a couple times.
The fuck?
It's like,
of course. Of fucking course.
Where it's just like they've made it a joke now, where it's like, what happened to so-and-so? Was it Q again? Damn it.
Oh, stuff man. Like that.
And they definitely address all the tropes and stuff. It's really good. Like, I really enjoy
it. Are they all red shirts? Are there any red shirts in this main cast?
The Kick-Ass and the Rebel are red.
Huh.
But
of course they are.
The other two are yellow and blue.
Okay.
But yeah, I would suggest us covering this, except for the fact that it's one of those shows where they will tell, like, a season-long plot that comes up at the beginning and at the end, but most of it is just one-off episodes.
And also with comedies, like, explaining the joke doesn't mean, makes it less funny.
Yeah.
I guess so, but also, the thing is, this is one of those where it's like case of the week type things.
Because yes.
What they're doing is they're kind of sort of trying to do like a little spoof on like The Office and stuff, where it's just like a workplace comedy.
Oh, gotcha.
They don't ever talk to the camera or anything, but it's just like, this is what it's like a day in the life of these people. Like, sometimes they're off doing this great space stuff, but sometimes they're just cleaning off from the previous adventure.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
And it's really cool. I would go into more detail, but I've taken too long. I've only seen one other thing, and that was Tony. I saw Renfield.
Oh, you did? What'd you think?
Yep. It's on a Peacock.
You saw what I saw, right? You get what I'm trying
to say. Yep. Yep, Nicolas Cage is full on Nicolas Cage, like where him as Spider-Man Noir is like one side of Nicolas Cage. This is the other side of him going full Nicolas Cage.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's fucking beautiful. And did you did you see what I saw with the whole Bela Lugosi look like resemblance in Nick's performance?
I mean, he has a similar facial structure and everything, so makes sense.
It looked so good. So good.
Yeah. Yeah, he and the makeup department, damn. Like, I don't want to even get into detail because of spoiling, but definitely some stuff where, oh, like, damn, the makeup department. Tony, you know what I mean.
Oh, fuck yeah. I know exactly what you mean.
But it was really good. Also, I don't know if I knew this or not, but, damn it, I forgot his name now, but dude from Parks and Rec, who's Sonic the Hedgehog now.
Oh, yeah, I know who you're talking about.
He's in it.
Oh, cool.
As like a secondary villain.
Oh, so that's who that fuck nugget crime mafioso was. Okay, I understand now.
Yep.
Dan.
Yep, he was kind of like a secondary villain for Awkwafina.
Yeah, he was weak as fuck. Even when...
But he was funny.
He was funny.
He was funny. And I would definitely like to see some combination of those four, including Nicholas Holt, who was amazing as a lead character.
Mm-hmm.
I would love a combination of those four actors in something else.
Yeah, it looks fun. The trailer looked really fun. Now that you tell me it's on Peacock, I'll definitely have to check it out.
Yeah,
and I think this might be my second favorite performance from Awkwafina. Number one is still Shang-Chi.
I was about to ask.
My favorite from her is Crazy Rich Asians. Shang-Chi is probably number two.
I don't think I've seen Crazy Rich Asians.
You should. It's a great movie.
I've heard. I just never got around to it. But yeah, Renfield is really good. Tony already went into detail, so I won't go into too much detail. But like I said, it was really good. I really liked it. The writing and the acting was great. It was honestly probably the funniest movie that I've seen all year.
Oh, that's high praise. But all right.
Yeah,
well, 2023 movie. Like,
yeah, I got it.
Came out in 2023. But and it makes me excited because the director is actually fairly new.
Oh, cool.
He did The Tomorrow War with Chris Pratt. But he's most notably known for his first feature-length movie. And that is Lego Batman.
Oh, shit! I love Lego Batman. That movie was amazing.
Interesting. Okay, okay.
Yep. And he's actually one of the movies that he supposedly got that's in the works. He's a Johnny Quest movie, and I can't wait to see that.
Oh, cool.
I am interested to see what they do with that.
They gotta get... they need to get the guys who did Venture Brothers to write for that movie.
Please. Listen, folks. Give us what we fucking want. God damn it. Don't make things complicated and difficult. We just want something.
Well,
please.
They might want to do something good, but different from Venture Brothers, because Venture Brothers is itself a Johnny Quest parody.
Oh, and Venture Brothers is getting its own movie. It does have a trailer out. Cap mentioned it before. Yeah. So, yeah, definitely check that one out. Before we jump into Tony's screen time, I did realize that I forgot a show that I watched that I would like to mention in screen time. So, big shout out to our boy David, iKingDavid95D. I actually hopped into a watch along reaction stream with him on his Twitch channel, and one of the shows that we watched, aside from Oshinoko in the English dub, was the latest episode of Hell of a Boss, which is actually the season one finale of Hell of a Boss, which was delayed for a while because of legal issues. And they had a huge guest star for this particular episode of Hell of a Boss, playing a female version of Beelzebub. And she is like, the theming for her, she is named Beelzebub, and she is like, her design is very like bee-like aesthetically. She has like the legs and the singer and shit, but she also has this like kitsune vibe to her. She has like a fox face and like extra tails and shit. It looks awesome, but it gets better, because she is voiced by none other than Kesha. Motherfucking Kesha.
Nice.
What?
And the song that she did, Cotton Candy, was an absolute banger. It sounded like classic Kesha, like Timber, TikTok era Kesha. It was amazing.
What?
Guys. Yeah. Guys. Like, I have praised the fuck out of Hell of a Boss for a while, but, like, I unapologetically love Kesha, both, you know, when she first came out and now that she's free to be herself. But that was such a nice surprise. Literally, I was watching it, and she started talking, and I'm like, she sounds really familiar. She sounds just like Kesha. I'm like, there's no way they actually got Kesha, though. They probably got some impersonator. And then we get to the credits at the end with special guest Kesha and Beelzebub. I was like, oh my god, it really was Kesha. What? Dude, that was amazing. Go watch it, you guys. Support Hell of a Boss. It's an independently made animated series, completely funded by the fans, put out on YouTube. Go watch it, please. It's amazing. Also, where the fuck is Hasbin Hotel? That shit's been... I've been waiting on that shit for so long, and the next part, the next episode has not come out. I want to know what's going on. Anyways, that's it for my screen time for real this time. Tony, what do you have for us this week?
Just a couple of things, we already talked about Oshinoko. Obvious plug is obvious. Check that shit out when it is available. One thing that I would like to say, as a part of what was initial programming for this podcast, I checked out the first season of Superman and Lois. And I have opinions on that shit.
I'm excited to hear them when we do the Superman and Lois episode, for sure.
Yep, I decided to take a bit of a small break from season two because I felt uncomfy. And you'll understand why I felt uncomfy when we talk about it in said actual discussion for that show. And then, continuing on that superhero train, I decided, just on a whim, to replay the PS4 Spider-Man game, but... not just that, but I just decided to play Miles Morales' story again. Had a great time with it.
Nice.
Took me a while to actually reacclimate myself to the controls, but hey, c'est la vie.
Understandable.
Incredibly entertaining. Also, I gotta say, man, watching certain things just pop out of the ether. And people just have the most interesting and ridiculous hot takes I will ever hear on the face of this internet, you know?
Oh, yeah. For sure.
You know, you know. Some of y'all are fucking stupid.
I mean, just last week, y'all went on a whole thing about it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, dude, that review was terrible. Like... so those are some major, major, like, atomically hot takes.
Those were, would you say that they were Swamp Thing or Man Thing levels of toxic?
For sure. They were fucking Simpsons Radioactive Man levels of toxic.
Oh no, not Simpsons Radioactive Man. Oof.
You have to make the distinction because Marvel has its own Radioactive Man.
Mm-hmm. And
what about Toxic Avenger?
Fair comparison.
But one thing is for sure, if you want to talk about anything that you want to bring back, because I checked out I had a little thought experiment to myself. You know what? Alternate universes are fun. You know what I did? Went down the amalgam rabbit hole again.
Oh, after, man.
So many years.
Good times.
Oh.
Dark Claw was still really cool. I think Dark Claw was a dope concept.
Yeah. But one thing is for sure, if they brought it back in this day and age, shit would be fuck wild.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
And here's a question I will pose to you folks, both the ones here on panel and the one. And the folks at home, if you had to choose one Marvel and one DC character for a new reboot of the Amalgam Universe, which two would you choose then?
Alright.
Which two to tell? Let us start with Brian. Luckily for you, just have to choose one Marvel character and one DC character.
Ooh.
They have to have similar power sets, similar backstories, and comparable rogues gallery to make things a little bit more easier.
That you said to make things easier. That kind of...
well, I mean, Storm and Wonder Woman aren't comparable, and they became a fusion.
Very true. Very true. Jay is right. So, you could just pull things out of the ether. That you think
you can literally do what the people who made that did and pull combinations out of your ass Or a hat. Yep. Or an ass hat.
Ass hats. Amazing.
Well, shit.
I feel like I should insert some copyright-free Jeopardy music here, but which I'm just gonna leave the silence just because it's palpable.
Yes, the silence is palpable. We're letting our man cook.
They're not comparable, and they're arguably my favorite from each. But I think it would be cool if we got something like Spiderwing.
Oh, Peter. So Nightwing and Spider-Man. Interesting.
Okay. Elaborate on that, Brian.
No, I mean they are comparable. They're both like quippy. They're both quippy 30 somethings. Who aren't
agile stuff.
Oh, that means Peter would have like the best, the super best button comics, because he already has, arguably, he has the best button Marvel. If you've seen a lot of his covers.
Mm-hmm.
Well, also we've seen now in Across the Spider-Verse what could happen if someone with like ballet dance training got spider powers.
Yeah, yeah.
With Spider Gwen, what about someone who's already had acrobatics training?
Oh yeah, true.
Okay, but here's the real question: here, would it be Dick Parker or Peter Grayson?
I like Peter Grayson.
Yeah, same.
Perfect.
Dick Parker leads to a lot of jokes.
But that's the beauty of it. Unintentional comedy. Fucking beautiful.
Yeah, I'd like to park her.
Exactly. I'm glad she thought of the exact same joke that instantly came to my mind when Tony said that name combination.
Brilliant.
For me?
Brilliant.
For me, this one is a shout out to all the furries out there. I'm gonna go ahead and combine Tigra with... I think the proper combination to go DC and Marvel would be, I would combine Cheetah and Black Cat.
Okay. Interesting.
So, it would be Black Cat with the, you know, sexy Cheetah powers, and... You know, she would also still have her black, her like bad luck abilities, which are often forgotten about.
Nice.
And then, you know, put her up against other like avatars of different deities of like luck, misfortune, shit like that. I think that could be really cool.
Okay. Okay. I see you. All right.
Yeah. And, just real quick, Peter Grayson, I do imagine him going like kind of like more of the Miles Spider villains, where it's more down to earth, animal theme type stuff.
Okay.
I also think Night Spider is a good name combination as well.
I like that too, Night Spider, because it's funny that you bring up Spider-Man and Nightwing there, Brian, because I have something very interesting for you gentlemen.
All right, let's hear it.
Picture it, if you will. New Gotham City.
All right. Activating imagination machine.
In an alley that's called Hell's Alley. In this part of the city, it is protected by its own guardian devil, made from the idea to put the fear of God in criminals. A billionaire lawyer by day, a crime-fighting vigilante by night. Matthew Wayne is the Bat Devil.
Oh, shit! That's like so, that's so simple and straightforward, but so cool!
Yeah.
About it, gentlemen.
And
combining the Joker and Wilson Fisk.
Oh, the King Clown of Crime.
Yes, exactly.
That sounds terrifying.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The point. Think about it. You can have similar origins where Matt Wayne, in this case,
yep,
loses his eyesight in an accident when his parents were gunned down and was taken in by a boxer that trained him, that treated him like his own son.
And then he hires that boxer to be his butler?
Yes, in a way.
Interesting.
A battling Jack Pennyworth.
Oh, that'd be cool. I'd be down for this.
Alright. All the bat-themed gadgets, it would be stripped down to just the usage of the billy club and the batarangs.
Alright.
Nice. And there is a connection between Matt and Peter, so.
Oh, yeah. And having interesting street-level heroes become members of this version of the Bat family. Hello.
Yeah, that could be super dope.
Oh yeah. Although, I got a question for you. How would you feel about Electra Quinn?
That would be very interesting.
That would be great.
Because interesting thing about Matt, some of his villains are very comparable to Bruce's.
They are.
And you can do a lot of things. I know the typical thing is to do Bullseye and the Joker. But that's not fun.
Yeah, that's not as creative. The King Clown of Crime just sounds awesome.
Yeah, and even more terrifying. And I think combining Bullseye with Slade Wilson is a much more interesting.
You want to know what I think is a better combination than Elektra and Harley Quinn? What about this? Think about now. Picture this, right? You got a psychiatrist who develops psychic abilities, and eventually her own powers drive her insane, and then she starts going by the name of Typhoid Harley.
I love it.
Interesting.
I love it.
Interesting.
And it would be a lot easier to combine Talia and Elektra.
Oh yeah, that's what I was thinking as well.
Elektra Al Ghul.
Nice.
Oh man.
But we'll leave that question for you folks at home. Give us your combinations and the little interesting stories you would tell with those combinations.
Dude, we might do this as a fan fiction later.
Yeah, and also, I just want to point out something.
All right.
The universe giveth, and the universe taketh. You didn't have any side tangents in that one video, so now you have all the side tangents.
Fair enough, but guess what? I'm leaving these side tangents in because these are interesting side tangents. But because now that we've had those side tangents out of the way, let's get to the discussion proper.
Yes. Let us talk about Skull Island.
Dun dun dun. King Kong ain't got shit on me! I know that's Training Day, but still, I've always wanted to yell that at something.
Gentlemen, have you ever felt
like a plastic bag drifting through the wind, waiting to start again?
Well, every so often, but that's not the point I'm trying to make here, Jay. The point I'm trying to make is that the ocean is a terrifying mistress.
This is exactly why I have a deep-seated fear of water that I cannot see the bottom of.
Oh, fuck. Yeah.
Yes, like, this show this show confirmed that fear for me, and I'm like, no, this fear is not irrational. This fear is completely rational. Because that shit is fucking scary. So, guys,
are you dealing with sea monsters? Fuck no.
This is going to be our spoiler-free section, so don't worry about it. We are just going to talk about our initial thoughts about the show, and we'll give you guys our standard cursory warning when we're going to jump into spoiler territory. And if you just want to skip to the spoilers, I will leave a chapter there for you to just jump right to it if you're interested in hearing our full spoiler discussion. But let's start with Brian. What did you think about the show? You were the first to finish it, so how'd you feel?
It was far too short, but really good for what it was. And the other thing about a good monster thing, that some people seem to, like, usually use as an afterthought sometimes, is the fact that you have to have a good, like, person's story to go along with it. And it was really good. It takes a while for them to build up to meeting the king himself. And that build up is worth it. And the stories are really good. And I really enjoyed it. And I love how they took a time for one episode in particular to veer off and do like a flashback with none of the normal human characters.
Oh yeah, that was actually, I think, my favorite episode of the show, this season in particular.
Yeah, and it was really cool, and there were some really cool monster designs. Kind of reminded me a bit of, like, Pokemon meets, if y'all remember this older show, Monster Rancher.
Yeah,
I also played the video game.
Yeah, and it was really cool. And also, one other thing that I don't know if y'all know about this show is that it's done by WB Animation, but it's also done.
Wait, WB? Isn't this Legendary though?
Yeah.
Oh, right, Legendary is Warner Brothers. That's why the Godzilla and Kong stuff are on HBO Max. Never mind.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And this is done by Warner Brothers Animation, but it's also done by the same animation that did Castlevania.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's what I thought, because it looked very much like Castlevania.
Yeah, but also, the humans kind of reminded me a bit of Young Justice too.
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit. Yeah. I mean,
so I can kind of see it, but whatever they did, it's definitely very good and beautiful, and they definitely, like, managed to make the monsters look otherworldly, which was really cool. And I know we're not getting into spoilers, but damn, Dog was awesome.
You know what it actually reminded me of? It reminded me of, what's it, Godzilla Monster Island, the cartoon from the Hanna-Barbera cartoon from the 70s?
Oh, yeah.
I remember. With fucking Godzuki!
Yeah, I love Godzuki! Godzuki's adorable!
Flew. Flying. Yep. Master, I love that guy. Love him.
And the spirit bond with King Kong?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I remember something that was buck wild back in, like, the late 90s, early 2000s. There's this Godzilla animated series. Also a little bit of a Kong series, too, where they fucking soul merge with the Kaiju.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
That's the Kong. That, it was...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I remember that. That shit was fucking awesome.
And, But one thing I like about this show, aesthetically... fucking gorgeous.
Oh yeah.
Like the adult characters, holy shit, they are fuckable.
Right? They are jacked. Everybody's jacked. Cap is jacked. Fucking Sam is jacked. Like Mike's dad was jacked.
By the way, as a fun fact, you made me think about it. The Middle Eastern mercenary is voiced by It's voiced by, what's his name?
I don't know, you tell me.
Gideon, the magic store seller from Vox Machina.
Oh, cool.
And, but the funny thing that is,
so he was
the dude who the dude who is always flirting with Vex.
Yeah.
That is Gilmore, but yes.
Gilmore, sorry, but brain's kind of fresh today. But anyway, the same voice actor who did Gilmore did that guy. And do you know what that guy's character name was?
What?
What was it, Brian?
Handsome Merc.
Nice. I would rather be known as Handsome Merc than Ugly as Fuck Merc.
Or Crybaby Merc, who looked like he was straight out of, like, Ultimate Captain America, Ultimate fucking Nuke.
Oh, yeah, you talking about the bitch-ass dude with the glasses?
No, I was talking about the bitch with the American flag tattoo on his arm.
Oh, yeah.
Looked a bit scruffy.
Yeah, who?
By the you know what?
Yep. So, yeah.
I can't prove it because I didn't find it online. But that definitely sounded a lot like, what's his name? Jake from Adventure Time.
Oh, John DiMaggio? It definitely, it sounded a lot like John DiMaggio. Definitely. Wouldn't surprise me. John DiMaggio is in everything.
Mm-hmm. Talented guy, though.
Yep. So, I really enjoyed the fuck out of this show. As I was telling Brian, as I was watching it, this shit flew by because I was so engrossed. And it reminded me of Castlevania in the sense of this show does not fuck around. People die. Like, frame one. People fucking die. You see blood and viscera and all that shit. So, like,
ooh, episode one.
You do not want to you don't want to sit down and watch this with the fam unless your kids are like 12, 13, then I'm sure that's okay. But, like, this was crazy. The action was really good, and like Brian said, they did something that is usually very difficult for animated shows where the larger-than-life character is, you know, the big draw. And they made the human characters actually interesting. And, like, people we cared about, right? Like, the biggest example of how shows have done a poor job of doing that, or movies in the past, is look no further than Transformers. In the good Transformers series, you actually care about the people that are teaming up with the Autobots. But in everything else, the humans are just kind of fodder and get in the way.
They were booty.
Might I mention the infamous quote? I am directly under the enemy scrotum.
Ah, oh, man. Mm.
Yeah. Nothing but booty shorts.
But yeah, absolutely. The humans were all very interesting. I love Annie. Mae Whitman is a treasure. I've heard her voice a million times. She was April. She was Katara. She was Rose in American Dragons Drake Long. Several other iconic roles. But she was great as Annie. Her relationship with Dog is absolutely adorable and a nice parallel with Kong and his backstory. Also, I want a dog puppy plushie ASAP. Baby Dog is the cutest fucking thing I've ever seen.
Yes.
It's like a big fucking pug. I want him now.
He's like a pug with, like, a lion mane and spikes. Yeah. It's so cute.
Yeah.
Like I said, give it to me now, please.
Yeah, exactly. I will buy that merch day one if it drops.
Pop up the product, and I will give you my money.
Exactly. Shut up and take my money already.
Mm-hmm.
Or as the young people go.
Exactly. See that, audio people? You completely missed out on a joke because you can't see what Brian just did there.
Mm-hmm. But also, one thing that I want to mention is, much like what Brian mentioned, it has that slow burn to the actual, like, confrontation, like in kaiju movies, because that's what people don't realize when it comes to kaiju films. And someone who has a little bit of an intimate knowledge when it comes to those kinds of films myself, the human characters are a bit superfluous in a way. They just get the plot going.
Oh yeah.
They know it's all about the dudes in the rubber suits, or in this case, for legendary CGI, to beat the fuck out of each other. And
I mean, that's what gets the butts in the seats.
The less we talk about Godzilla talking to Anguirus in when they fight Gigan and King Ghidorah, the better, because it's fucking nutty and hilarious. But Kong, perfectly used in this show. And it's perfectly, they marketed it in such a way that it's focused on Skull Island itself and not just Kong. Because the ecology here on Skull Island is fucking weird.
He has, also, like, Kong has a lot of personality, even in the few frames that you see in the beginning before he's fully shown. Like, he leaves you intrigued, like, you know, why is he acting like this? This is interesting. I want to know more. But yeah, Tony's right. The fucking ecology on this island is wild. They got, like, fucking living diamond rock bugs. They got fucking aloe turtles.
Crabs the size of fucking cars.
That look delicious. I want to eat it.
I want to eat outdoor crabs.
Those are big meaty claws.
Tasty. Also, fucking plants that will consume you whole.
Oh man, they had a fucking real life victory bell, like wild.
And a big.
They even named it themselves, Alice in Wonderland. They looked like the Alice in Wonderland plant.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Also, big fuck you, bird.
Oh yeah, that bird that I thought was a phoenix at first, because it kind of looks like how like phoenixes are depicted in Harry Potter, the pink plumage and shit.
Get this.
You know
what its name is?
What's its name?
Hawk.
Oh yeah, right. Yeah, in the flashback they called it Hawk. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's also been by our.
Yeah. It's in like a symbiotic relationship with Kong, which is pretty cool. Mm-hmm. Which
kind of like his psychic.
Yeah, and actually in nature, gorillas also have like a partnership with birds as well.
Yeah, but you know what my favorite little creature that was found? Well, one of my favorite creatures.
What was it?
I have a couple. The fucking plant hedgehog.
Oh yeah.
That got by Kong in one episode, ate him like he was fucking candy.
Oh yeah, and then I thought those those lizards that Kong fought in the flashback were also really cool.
Big ass chameleons.
The giant chameleons.
Yeah,
those boys were dangerous. Love them. Love those scaly guys.
All right, so. Like, anything else spoiler-free you guys want to mention before we jump into the actual spoiler discussion? Would you recommend this to the folks at home?
Yes, we would recommend this.
Yes.
At least. But...
And I will say this for the people at home who aren't staying to the spoilers. There is one or two more giant creatures that were awesome, but we can't really talk about without spoilers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because... They are just built. Different.
Absolute menace. Absolute menace. You will see in episode one, I guarantee you, you will know by the end of episode one if you're gonna like this show.
Oh, yes. Everything about this show, the mysteries, the intrigue, what the fuck is going on Skull Island? Well, that last question may not be answered right away, but... All things come with time.
Yep,
but
yep, yep.
Let's get into those spoilers.
All right, folks, you heard the man. This is your obligatory warning. We are heading into spoiler territory. If you have not seen all 8 episodes of Skull Island, please back away, add this video to your watch later, and then come back after you've seen the show, because we are jumping into spoiler territory. Okay, now that the spoiler-free people are gone, let's just jump right into it. Holy fuck, that giant squid!
Man, yep. Was a menace, a terrifying creature of the sea.
Dude.
R.I.P. Hero. R.I.P. Yeah. Hero.
Dude, when he died... I literally was like out loud.
I said it out, dude. I said it out loud too. I was like, "Oh shit, episode one."
I said the same thing. Like, "Holy fuck!"
And he got like straight up splattered. Like you, like usually they cut away from that shit. No, you saw it.
And also, Mike getting like a bit of that blood bukkake. Hello.
Yeah, that was crazy.
No.
Damn.
No, sir. I will not. I will not accept you just crushing my dad like he was a fucking egg for an omelet.
Oh, man. And, like,
yeah,
I gotta say...
to a melon.
I gotta say, Mike is probably my favorite character of the kids.
Master was sassy as fuck. Yeah,
I will say,
him.
He's got the sass, man. Of course, that's my guy.
He is
so
my
much
son.
Sass.
Dude, he's got so much sass that he's literally dying.
Well, yeah, he was sick and dying and still giving sass. I respect it. That's how I would be on my deathbed. I'd still be talking shit.
Him and Charlie are my sons. I have adopted them.
Yep, same.
Which, by the way, if you ever want more of that actor, he also is in that show, Never Have I Ever.
Oh, cool. Oh yeah, something so, else. Just a fun little side note in the conversation I was having with Brian while I was watching it. I was like, man, I'm glad we didn't invite Cap to be a guest on this show, because it would get hella confusing. Because you know we'd be talking about Charlie's dad, who also goes by Cap, because we don't actually know the guy's name. So we'd be like, yeah, Cap was awesome, and then Cap would just be like, yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
it was just not you, Cap, other Cap.
Oh, here's something fun. That I thought it was super cool that they actually did this. They actually had this show is multilingual.
Oh yeah, I like that Hero and Mike like spoke to each other in Japanese. In the flashback, the humans spoke Spanish.
Yeah, all very fascinating. And yes, most of the shows in English or in Howl's. In Annie and Og's case.
Yep.
Which, oh my god, poor girl.
Yo, straight up, she has the backstory of Disney's Tarzan.
Yeah, but she adopted the child of her father's killer.
Which is so sweet, but also so fucked.
I mean, when you're the living on
but man, the scene where they share the hot dog, oh my god, my heart.
My heart broke.
Yeah, because you said that she befriends her dad's killer.
No.
Well,
he said the child of her dad's killer.
Yeah, that's what I meant to say. The child of her dad's killer. Well, her dad killed that child's parent, so...
Yeah,
they're kind of like both in the same boat.
Literally,
they live in a fucking boat.
They lived in the same boat for years.
Mm-hmm. And also, my God, Irene, why are you
so
bad?
I have to say, so initially I thought Irene was gonna be super annoying because of how cringe she started off as, but it became endearing over time. And I'm not gonna lie. As soon as I saw her face, I was like, oh, she's Annie's mom. I'm like, they look very similar.
I figured that too, but, I mean, we've been in the entertainment reviewing gig for so long, we just know these tropes like the back of our fucking hand.
Yeah.
Yeah, but also on addressing that point, I will give them kudos for not including the military who wants to use the monster.
Yeah, as a subplot. Yeah, it was just a rich mom trying to get her kid, which I appreciate it. It's not them trying to capture Kong and use him for military experiments or whatever.
Or capture dog to do whatever, because yep. Dog is just the OG.
Well, dog is pretty fucking awesome. I totally understand.
Yeah. Also,
like
I love dogs, just grumpy old man.
Man, the most fun relationship of the entire show is the frenemy-ship of Dog and Charlie.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah.
And it's like, I don't know why you're mad at me, Dog.
And Dog be thinking, you know why Dog is mad at you, Charlie, because Annie likes you, and he's protective of his sister.
Yeah, it's like, I don't want no pumpkins.
I can tell you want to bang my sister, Charlie.
Yeah, I can smell it. You desperate as fuck.
I could smell it. I wasn't even there, and I could smell it.
But Charlie definitely went through.
Man, Charlie definitely went through some shit, and he had some major character development for sure.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, where the hell is he?
I literally texted Brian after I finished. All caps, that's how you fucking end it?
Yeah, and I mean, look, the balls on them to do that, that is crafty as shit.
Oh yeah, you definitely want me to need more now, because where the fuck is Dog? Where the fuck is Cap? Where the fuck is Charlie?
Where is Mike dead? Tell me.
Yeah, did Mike die? Well, like, why are we in New York? I know the obvious reason of why we're in New York, because you want the whole classic Kong Empire State Building thing. You fucking lingered on the Empire State Building right there. Yeah, I know what you're doing, show.
I know what you're doing, show. You wink off, like, classic Kong cinema, but that's not really, like, winking off. It's, like, a classic nod, but
I got you.
Yeah, also, to the point. The main woman in the original Kong movie, her name was Anne.
Yep.
So.
Oh, yeah, that's
And we did see that Annie bonded with Kong because she reminded Kong of his own friend from the flashback because of her friendship with Dog.
Yep, and also Kong be thinking on that, like, actual timing, you know?
Yep.
It's like, if you were me, you know.
Also, like, sad simping Kong was just, that was.
Yeah, I don't. It's like, I'm okay with some things just being played off for funny, because simping is a real problem. It's a disease, fam. When Kong, the king. When he fucking simps, it means something, apparently.
It does.
And you feel for our big man when he be big simping for people, you know?
Oh, dude. When she died?
Man, that hurt me. Like, oh my god, the scene where he digs the grave and buries her. I was like, oh my god, this poor guy.
I was sad for him. It's like, bro, I know you lost people that you cared about, and the one thing that you two had, you fought over something ridiculous.
And like, that's the part that I think that probably eats away at the guy the most is that like, the last thing that they had was an argument where she called him a stupid animal, Kong was being all tsundere, and then, you know, he, like, when she dies, her last words are "my king," and I'm just like, oh my heart!
It sends you to the afterlife. It makes you go, well, goddamn.
Yeah.
You forgave.
And
that was a Bunny Girl Senpai truck moment right there.
And you know that he blames himself.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
if they weren't in an argument, he would have been with her.
I think the best thing that this show did was the fact that, like, they gave so much personality and emotion to Kong without having him be able to say a single word.
Oh, yeah, you could definitely tell just by the look on his
face. Yeah.
Like, the emotion on his face and the animation is just so good.
Oh, perfect. Just...
Yep.
Line. Also, the downright fear in his eyes when the squid was acting on that devil timon.
And then, like, the pure, unadulterated anger when he finally gets a chance to just fucking unleash all the rage he had pent up for what that squid did to his friends. Oh my god, the carnage.
Because to give them credit, it wasn't just his homegirl that he was mad about. Because when he first comes and sees the village, and you just see, like, the utter trauma on his face.
Yeah, he's just like, oh no, all my friends are dead.
It's because of that stupid squid. Because it got a taste of my fucking blood.
Yep.
Yeah.
Squid, I will tell you, that squid was on Demon Timon.
Oh, yeah. No, that squid, that was a Black Air Force-ass squid. Holy shit.
It was like, okay. So, I mentioned before, earlier in this podcast, that the octopus that Kong fights in Godzilla vs. King Kong back in the 1970s by Toei. Toho, I should say. Toei is something different entirely. My bad. Toho. Oh my god. That squid just reminded me of that octopus.
I'm sure that was a deliberate homage.
Yeah, and
and
terrifying, like, version of the octopus being that fucking piss off squid monster. Hell yeah.
And it's got, like, you know, jellyfish venom type shit that, like, again, is killing our boy Mike.
Also, gentlemen, I have two words for you.
What's that, Brian?
Tentacle horn?
Flying whale.
Oh, yeah.
That squid was like, hey, Kong.
Yeah, he yeeted a fucking whale. And I'm not gonna lie, when I saw the flying whale, like, I wanted to message Tony. I'm like, Tony, you made a cameo.
But I do remember that you did text me.
Yep. Yeah, a flying whale? question.
Yeah, that squid was deliberately...
Oh, man. That squid was so petty, and I love it.
Oh, here's something very interesting. Also, it's down to animal behavior, too. Most cephalopods are some of the most intelligent creatures on this planet.
Yeah, I've seen videos of, like octopi painting and shit.
And also, it would make sense to have a cephalopod be very intelligent. I mean, having a brain comparable to its size, it's fucking smart. And it knows how to get it.
Oh, yeah.
Yo, it dispatched that helicopter like it was nothing. It wasted no time.
It tore it apart like tissue paper.
That shit was wild.
Indeed. It was just bad.
But also, one thing that I love about this thing is that we don't see it outright eat people. It killed for a sport.
Yeah, no, you could tell that it was just doing this to fuck with people. Like, it wasn't because it was hungry or anything.
Also, they kind of pulled the whole Jaws method. Where we saw its tentacles and we saw its tendril things.
Yeah, we didn't see the full squid until, like, the big epic ass fight.
Oh yeah, and it's also very interesting because it's connected to Cap in a way.
Yeah.
At least the way that it presented to, at least to me, Cap was going on about
Sorry.
Did you just lose your mind there, buddy? What's going on with that?
Yeah, I was wondering. I was like...
No, I was going to say, actually, if you remember, that's not the monster that Cap saw.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Because Cap specifically says...
That's something else, yeah.
Yeah.
Because he saw it before. Like, Cap saw the squid before we did.
Yeah.
Yep.
And he was like, that's not the thing I saw years ago. That's something different. So what the hell is that?
I mean,
also,
I
the other thing that I love about this show is that, so for me, right? Mm. My grandpa, he loves old pulp novels, and I read a bunch of them as a kid, like Edgar Rice Burroughs and Jules Verne, all that shit. I have like a whole box of them that he gave me from his old house when we moved out of his house into our current house. And, like, this reminds me of that shit, especially because this goes into the whole Hollow Earth thing, which is actually a big concept in, believe it or not, the Tarzan novels. So, I don't know if you guys ever saw the Disney animated series for Tarzan, but they actually dive into one of the concepts in the novels, where... in the center of the Earth, there's actually a whole other Earth where dinosaurs are still around. They have a whole civilization dedicated to cheetahs and cheetah men. And there's a sexy lady in a cheetah skin cloak that has magical abilities to control the animals and, like, turn people into cheetahs. Her name is Queen La, and she's fucking awesome.
That sounds
she,
hot as
she
fuck.
She also rides the fucking T-Rex.
That sounds hot as fuck. Also, by the way, Hollow Earth stuff was included in Godzilla vs. Kong.
Yeah. Which,
Yeah, and also Land of the Lost.
Yep.
Also true. And the trailer for the next Kong and Godzilla film. The big fuck you ape? Hello?
Yeah, right? I'm excited, though. Mm-hmm. And again, I also love just the little references. Like, when that Merc, when they ask the Merc, like, who are you? Jules Verne.
That is hilarious, yeah. It's like, hey,
yeah,
is the squid really gonna care about who you are down to your fucking yearbook?
Right?
Just give me it's your Wells. Fucking name.
Thank you, Well.
Which also another callback to
yeah, Orson Welles, of course.
No, H.G. Wells.
Yep.
Which, by the way, as far as side characters go, I don't remember the character's name, but Phil the Mars mercenary dude.
You talking about Sam?
Oh yeah, Sam.
Sam.
Yeah. He was on that time and though with Irene. Hello.
Yeah, you know, you can tell they're a thing.
Hell yeah.
Like they definitely, you know, definitely, you know.
Yeah.
And to give Irene her credit, I did like that one scene where she was like, "Sam, I need to talk to you."
Oh yeah,
something.
Oh yeah. Can I show you something? And then like she just has a healthy cry in private. Like, also, I love her banter with Annie. My favorite one yeah. is where she's like, you know, she talks about what she went through and she talks about like how much therapy she had. And Annie's like, what's therapy? And she's like, of course I do, if I knew what therapy was. And then she explains what therapy is. And like, what's your plot? Like Annie says, that sounds bad. And then Irene just responds, no, actually, it's quite healthy. And I'm like, yeah. You tell her, Irene, it is healthy. Yeah. Advocate for that.
Yeah, Irene. I mean, you meant it as like a fucking joke, but yes, therapy is healthy, folks.
We here on the Channel Tasters podcast fully advocate for therapy. As two out of three of us do go to therapy regularly.
Yes, and some of us need to make sure that we're on the up and up, just to make sure that we stay We say balance. Say
listen, you always want to be even. And I think, like, mm-hmm. you know, that was definitely a struggle for Irene. Because, like, and I don't blame her, man. This shit was fucking stressful.
I mean, having the idea of burying your own child.
I can't even begin to imagine that, like,
yeah.
And then to have that, like, wound opened up again, only to, like, to get a sliver of hope, like, oh, your kid might be alive, the ship is there.
And to find out that your husband, yeah. or maybe ex-husband?
No, I think it was just regular husband.
I mean, they didn't really, like, outright specify that.
Because they heavily imply that she met Sam in, like, grief counseling group therapy, and Sam also lost a wife, like, his wife.
Yeah, I think that's the case, but that's another thing the show did excellently. They didn't put things...
They didn't spoon feed you.
Yeah, exactly. And,
mm-hmm.
how they feed you mystery after mystery. It's like, Mike's, when he first sees Irene, it's like, it's you.
And then she's like, you? And then, you know, Cap's like, wait, you guys know each other? Huh?
Like, what the fuck? Cap, God's sake.
Yeah.
Out of all the characters, I love this man.
Oh, yeah. Like, he reminds me of, like, an adventurer version of Reed Richards.
Oh, I had my comments. The special brand of commentary that...
Because he's so single-minded, but unlike Reed, he actually does make an effort to pay attention to his family.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Oh, yeah, indeed.
I had multiple things that I said. Looking like fucking Reed, Steven.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because Steven Strange has that same hairstyle, except for, like, the patches. So
he doesn't have the full-on beard. Cap has a great beard, also, by the way, as someone who appreciates facial hair. Cap had a great beard.
Yeah. But also, personality-wise, kind of also reminds me of the dad from Lost in Space.
I could see that.
True. I could see that, too, but I gotta say, like I said, thanks to the animation, the adult characters look fine. And that's talking about a
split. Oh, yeah.
I'm not talking about any of that weird timing that most people think about. You know, disassociation of reality and whatnot. Well, we're not getting into that. But
yep.
What I am saying is that these individuals, good lord.
Also, I love the background characters, like the other mercenaries, like the one girl mercenary who gave Cap sass. It's like, you know, it's like, it's like, what are you doing with that plant? It's like, packing it up. It's like, for what? Because you know, we want our chopper to be even heavier next time we get rescued.
Girl was sassy.
Yeah.
I like her.
Didn't she die?
I don't think so. She's still alive.
We don't know if most of the crew survived after Kong beat the shit.
Oh, yeah, we don't. Yeah, that is true.
Because, also, if you remember, the last we saw Cap, he was running back in the woods to try to save Charlie.
Yep, who was also in a very precarious situation.
Like, wasn't he about to get got by fucking...
The natives, yeah.
Yep.
I mean, they weren't going to kill him, right?
No, but I think they were going to torture him or do some shit because, like, you know, he fucked with Kong.
They said
something like, what did you do to our king, or why did you hurt our king?
Yeah, they're like, you will suffer for what you did to Kong, is what they said. It was the line.
Ah.
And then Charlie was like, Kong? Who the fuck is Kong?
Oh, gee. Maybe a little bit of context clues, you fucking goober.
Fair.
They're wearing monkey masks.
But yeah.
And our poor Mike was poisoned, but running after Cap to help with Charlie.
He still had a badass moment with that flare gun thing. That was cool as fuck.
Oh yeah, that was so cool. That was so cool.
Yeah.
Legendary, you did it again.
Yeah, the Godzilla cartoon that was on Netflix that they did was also great.
You did it again. You made me fucking care. You made me fucking care again.
Mm-hmm.
Kaiju movies.
Oh yeah, this show was fantastic. Highly recommend it. For sure.
I should say specifically.
So, yeah, let's go ahead and jump into final thoughts and ratings. We're going to go ahead and once again start with Brian. Then I'll go to me, and then we'll end off with Tony.
Sorry, had a little bit of IRL smashing.
Yeah, I was wondering why you were shaking over there. I was like, oh no, is Brian having a seizure?
I dropped something that I'm holding off camera.
Gotcha.
Because, fidgety, neurospicy. You know.
Your neurons are
spicy. But anyway, I did really enjoy the show. Like I said, I do think that it was too short. I get why they kept it short and sweet, but still would have liked to see more. But I did still really enjoy it. Like, it was great. But I don't know. Maybe it's me trying to fight the fact that I've been giving so many ratings around this. But I just feel like there were little things here and there where it wasn't perfect. It was still great, but it wasn't like perfect. So, but in the end,
it doesn't even matter. You tried so hard. You came so far. But in the end, it doesn't even matter.
Damn, RIP. But,
you put your press in us.
I guess maybe it's biased for me not wanting to give everything, like, around this rating. But, I think for what we got, it was great. But I would have wanted more. And some of the little things here and there were a little cliche. Like we said, like, it was obvious that she was Annie's mom. So I think in the end, this is still a really good grade. But I think out of 10, I'd give it an 8.5.
Okay, cool. Tradition continues. Also, because I didn't say it before, I have to rectify it and say it now. Annie's mom has got it going on.
Like indeed. She fine as hell.
She is fine as hell. I even think her little awkwardness is cute. It's quirky. Mm-hmm. I like it.
She knows she got it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And she's rich. I'd hit. But yeah, let's talk about final ratings for me. So, I thought this show was great. I actually think the breakneck pace really helped it a lot because you didn't really have time to breathe. Like, it just moved you from one thing to the next, and it really just kept you hooked and enthralled. Like Tony said, the show could have very easily been nothing but exposition dumps, and honestly, I probably would have liked it if it was very exposition dumpy, because the world and the island itself was just super fascinating, but they do a really good job of just the subtle moments of exposition that don't spoon-feed you things. They let you put things together yourself, like the relationship between Sam and Irene, the whole thing with, like, Kong and his people who lived in the village.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was all great.
Yeah. Little mystery team there. Perfect.
The emotion on Kong, like we mentioned before, is absolutely phenomenal. We actually care about the human characters, which is a feat within itself. But I don't think it has that enough juice to it to reach the level of a 9, because a 9 is like the highest score I can give something that isn't Sandman. So I gotta go with my gut here and give Kong or give Skull Island season 1 an 8 out of 10. Fantastic show, would highly recommend it. And I think, you know, it is such a breeze to watch. Before you know it, it'll be over and you'll be like, what the fuck? Where are my guys? Where'd my sons go? Tell me where my sons are, damn it.
Yeah.
Give me back my children.
Alright, Tony. Final thoughts and ratings.
Well, gentlemen, you know what I thought of this as instead of a TV show?
What?
A much longer kaiju movie.
Okay, fair enough.
So I treat it like a kaiju movie. The episode breaks. Been annoying, but hey. Sometimes that just happens. Overall, great. Great way of really exploring a different facet to Skull Island. We get to see different cool things of the ecology. We get to see a Skull Stalker again from the Legendary Kong film. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Well, and I gotta say, as much as I enjoy it, and as I am a huge fan of kaiju movies myself, I cannot, in good conscience, give it higher than an 8.5. So I'm agreeing with Brian on this one.
Yeah, because you guys can see what I was trying to do with that internal conflict.
It's yeah.
It's a great show. But it just doesn't feel.
It doesn't feel like a 9. You know, I guess spoiler for anybody who did not watch our Bloodhounds episode yet. We get Bloodhounds 9, like all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And that show was absolutely phenomenal. The only reason we couldn't give it a 10 was because there were still problems we had with it that didn't make it perfect.
Yes, and with this, it's just the way it is for just media in general, that we will always have differing opinions on the things we enjoy. I looked at it from the perspective of someone who has watched kaiju movies since they were a small child. And so I'm used to these shows, so I'm used to the ideas of the human characters just kind of being a bit superfluous. And they are just very minor. And then coming to realize that the monsters were meant, they were trying to put this balance of the monsters and the human characters, which Skull Island did put that proper balance. I mean, granted, we saw a lot of interesting creatures. We didn't see Kong, which was very fitting because it was just called Skull Island. But with Brian, I saw his point with just very hard to grade a show that, in all honesty, should have been a film instead of a show.
I can see that.
And it's just...
Yeah, I can see that.
It wouldn't be a bad thing to have an animated film series that's, like, pseudo-prequels to, like, Kong's side of the MonsterVerse complex.
Oh, so like kind of like, you know, for anime terms, like an OVA series kind of thing.
Yeah, it's kind of like how when Gintaro Ibuchi wrote the Godzilla Earth trilogy.
Oh yeah,
and it's kind of like that, but it's told in the same universe as the MonsterVerse.
Mm-hmm.
Not its own separate thing, because Godzilla Earth is fucking metal.
Oh, it is wild.
But, yeah, Brian, yet again, you and I agree on a rating, and Jay is just 0.5 below us. But
keep
still,
that tradition, man. That just seems to be how it is. You know, I'm always 0.5 below.
Yeah, so, or...
Unless it's Sandman.
Oh, yeah, unless it's Sandman, where I'm 0.5 above.
Or you're with me on just kind of seeing a lot of the points, because I think you and I had similar ratings when it came to Across the Spider-Verse.
Yeah, we had similar ratings. We had the same rating in Across the Spider-Verse. We were all unanimous with Bloodhounds. And then you and I were 0.5 apart in, or no, you and I were a point apart in Oshinoko. I will not give away the rating here. You guys should watch that video to see what that is.
As you totally should.
But,
and then our one with Cap.
Yeah, that's what.
Oh, yeah, yeah, the Young Justice one with Cap, where we, where me and Brian agreed, and Cap was 0.5 below us.
That is very interesting, but point is, folks, when it comes to media like this, some of us have a little bit more knowledge, as you've probably have seen.
Yep, knowledge and attachment.
In the past, with a few episodes, like Exo Kitty, for example, I didn't know much about the original source material, so I just saw it as a new viewer perspective. When it came across, Jay, Cap, and myself had a huge love for the entangling web of the multiverse as far as Spider-Man's concerned with.
Yep. And then, you know, with Sandman, both Tony and I were, like, huge fans of the comics. They were big influences, you know, on our own, like, writing and, like, how we perceived a lot of stuff.
And, like, the whole writing philosophy and whatnot. But also, with this, I think we've talked about our experiences with kaiju films in the past.
Yeah, we have.
And didn't we agree that out of the three of us, I had the more extensive knowledge on it?
Yeah, because you went back and watched a lot of these older stuff. And I mean, I have, and I know a lot of the lore, but most of what I know comes from, like, comics that I've read, because I, like, whatchamacallit, I think it was IDW. IDW has this amazing Godzilla series that I've read for, like, the longest time. They also had a mini series called Godzilla in Hell that Corey got that was amazing.
Yeah, and with
My experience with it is that I've seen some of the classic stuff and some of the new stuff. I'm not really attached as much to the mythos, but I have seen some of the stuff, especially the classic old movies.
Yeah, and I've also gone down the kaiju rabbit hole because I actually have a collection of Gamera movies.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so when it comes, kaijus and I, we go back.
I played that old kaiju fighting game. I thought that was fucking awesome.
Godzilla Attack on Monsters Melee.
Yep.
Destroy Monsters Melee. Love that game. But here's a fun fact about me, folks, and I think you guys will get a kick out of this too. My grandparents, these are my mom's parents, took me and my sister out to see Godzilla 2000 in theaters.
Oh, shit.
And that is a memory I will always recall, because in typical westernizing fashion, we had dubbed over the lines for the human characters and whatnot in typical Godzilla films, because that's always been a thing. And that shit has always been hilarious. So I begged when the VHS, mind you, the VHS for that film came out, I begged and pleaded just to get it, only to have my grandparents buy it so they could just keep it at their house. And when that time came when my grandfather passed, I grabbed all the Godzilla movies I could, took them home with me, and they've been in my care ever since.
Oh, nice. That's sweet.
Nice.
They weren't willed to me in any way, but those films were mine. They were something that I shared with my grandfather.
That's cool. That's like what I talked about last week in the Bloodhounds episode. You know, why I love boxing so much is because, you know, that's how I connected with my grandfather before he passed.
For those people at home who might not know, out of the three of us, I'm the one who's not like a legacy nerd. I am self-trained.
Well, my grandfather wasn't really a nerd himself. He was a carpenter in life, and he just focused on a lot of different things. He was a very soul of the earth kind of man. So he did his damnedest to understand one of his younger grandchildren. That being little old me. Because I wasn't like... I wasn't like any of my cousins on my mom's side of the family. I was that quirky child. And also it didn't hurt that I was the grandchild of one of my grandfather's favorite children. So that being mine.
Yeah. That's why I get special treatment around my mom's family in California. I guess also because I'm the oldest, I'm legit the only one any of them remembers. Like, they'll say they'll mention me, and they'll just completely forget that I have two other brothers.
Damn. But here's thing. Another interesting fact. Not to get too much into it, but my grandfather was the one that knew about me being on the spectrum before my mom even did. And he said, you know, Tony's mom's name, what's going on with your boy? He hasn't talked starting at 3.
Ah, okay.
Because I was very tight-lipped when I was very small. And I used to talk through my teeth.
Interesting.
So, are those things that cement? Well,
yeah, I can understand why kaiju movies have such a special place in your heart, for sure.
Yeah.
Because
indeed,
it's those memories of being there, and with Skull Island, sure, I have those memories again of just like watching a good kaiju story. But much like with what Brian said, we can tell the tropes like right off the bat. But where's the fun in just harping on the predictability?
Yeah, and I mean, like, that's the point of like the new mantra of the podcast, right? We're only reviewing shows that we like, and you know, even with Spider-Verse, where you know, like we mentioned before, where like you know, we had that nerd rage. That was out of love and passion. That wasn't out of hate. Or, like, any kind of visceral, fuck this movie kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
The hate that we had, the quote-unquote hate that we had during Spider-Verse is a completely different monster than if we were ever to cover Flash.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It was...
Yeah.
How a character interpretation changed an outlook for the character from its original... Page counterpart, you know? And that was the thing that stuck a craw in my jaw, you know?
Yep. But yeah, hope you guys enjoyed... And, oh yeah, my bad, Brian. Go ahead.
It's okay, I just wanted to cap off by saying that the reason why I mentioned the negatives was just to explain working it out in myself of why I felt like it didn't deserve to have a 9.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
True.
But I will say that it does seem like, minus somewhat Exo Kitty, so far in this new iteration, there really hasn't been something that has been exclusively something me. But people, let's just say, look out for...
That's not entirely true. I was going to say, that's not entirely true. Because, like... While Tony was a critter, you're a bigger critter than Tony is.
Well, I mean, in this new version of on YouTube.
Ah, yeah. Okay.
I see. I get your point. But
I will just say, because I was also trying to give you an out, Jay, because I was going to say that if you want something that is more me nerding out. Let's just wait till like somewhere in November or December when a certain specials come out.
Oh yeah, that's true. The Doctor Who specials for sure. And then you'll see me nerd out like for a franchise that I love, especially in August when the TMNT movie comes out. I fucking love the Turtles. So
you know, also comes out in August there, gentlemen.
Oh yeah, Blue Beetle, the boy Jaime. That's the dude. Yeah.
Why not have an entire discussion roundtable on the one, the only I'm a Reyes.
Oh yeah, no, best believe, folks at home and folks listening, we are doing a Blue Beetle episode and we're doing a Turtle episode. Normally we do a one movie per month kind of rule, but I can't miss an opportunity to talk about the Turtles.
Oh hell yeah.
And the Blue Beetle thing, Tony, was already in the books, like before the first episode of
when we saw the suit. Me and Brian were like, oh yeah, we're covering this.
Yeah, and when I saw the trailer, I was like, oh yeah, this is so me.
But yeah, look forward to that. Now, I finally get to tell you guys. So, as Tony alluded to in his screen time, we were originally going to cover Superman and Lois as next week's episode of the podcast. However, we discovered that season 3 does not come on HBO Max until the 27th. So, we gotta wait a little bit. So, in the meantime, we're actually going to cover one of the shows that we just reacted to once again. We're probably going to cover Celebrity, because it's actually perfect timing. So,
yes,
here we go.
And I know some people out there who might know it are like, why don't you watch it on the CW app? Well, one, the CW app is trash.
It is.
And two, it's bound to spoil the show that you're watching.
Yeah, because, like, when I was watching season 2, and I was catching up to season 2, like, at the time, because, like, if you know how the CW works, if you're watching, like, if you're trying to watch, like, the later episode, like, the current episodes of a season, they're not on Max, you have to watch it on the app. I was catching up on season 2, and right before, like, I got an answer to a plot point, I saw a trailer for the episode that was coming up that week of Superman and Lois Season 2, which told me the answer I was looking for. And I was like, well, shit, there goes the surprise there. So I straight up told the boys, I'm like, yeah, you know, maybe it's not going to spoil us if the show's already over, but also you gotta remember the show did just wrap up, so they probably still have those ads in the rotation.
Yeah, and also, he said the 27th of July.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So a whole month, but so likely we haven't talked about this off camera, but likely it's looking like Superman and Lois, which we're still going to do, is probably going to come out the episode before our Turtles episode.
Yep.
Yeah. And, you know, it is what it is. Plus, looking more into K-dramas, specifically a very more interesting K-drama, as opposed to what we got in Bloodhounds, you know?
And you folks seem to like our like, K-drama coverage. I mean, Exo Kitty doesn't fully count, but like we said, it has a lot of K-drama elements. You guys liked the Bloodhounds episode, from what we can tell, in terms of engagement. So, clearly, you know, it's not something our audience shies away from. So, if you give us a reason, we'll continue to do the K-drama stuff, because we fucking love these.
Yeah, it's a bit outside of our usual element, our usual wheelhouses.
But I think that's what makes it more fun, right?
We're like, here for it.
Yeah.
Well, it also sets up the precedence so that we can cover the bigger case stuff when it comes out, like season 2 of Squid Game and season 2 of All of Us Are Dead.
Oh, wait! It's confirmed to get a season 2? Oh, shit! Hell yeah, man! That's hype.
So that means I have to play Mega Catch-Up
again. I mean, it's not Mega Catch-Up. All of Us Are Dead was super short. And then it's only got one season.
It was about the same size as Squid Games.
And Bloodhounds.
I was just making a joke.
Gotcha. But yeah, That's a lot of stuff to look forward to. Once again, I just want to reiterate, thank you everyone for supporting the podcast and our return to YouTube. And thank you, audio-only audience, for supporting us on Spotify as well. Remember, if you want to hear the podcast a day early, go follow us on Spotify and listen to it. Of course, you're missing out on a big element in a lot of our little inside jokes here. If you don't watch the YouTube version, but you know how you can rectify that? Just watch both.
Exactly. And you want to keep up to date with our various opinions on this podcast? There are three simple ways to make sure that you can get a hold of us.
Yep.
By subscribing to the channel, liking each video, and also put your notifications on. Because if you want to hear our lovely voices ad nauseum talking about different shows, you got to make sure those notifications are always on.
Yep, that bell does matter, folks. Don't forget to ding it.
And also, don't forget to comment down below to tell us your thoughts and opinions on Skull Island. Or answer the question I proposed earlier.
Or any of the various other things we talked about in the different segments as well.
Exactly.
Like I mentioned before.
What you want to see in the future.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We're always down to take recommendations. So whatever you guys want to talk about, feel free to mention in the comments down below. And you will be featured in our brand new segment, Comment Quarter, like I keep saying. I know I've repeated it several times, but comment and engagement are super important to algorithm-san, and we got to please him. So... you know,
yeah,
do what we can.
Algorithm-kun, he's a very fickle creature.
He is.
He's like that diamond crab bug monster from Skull Island.
So help us out as much as you can. Do all the usual YouTube things. But thank you guys for tuning in to a new episode of the Channel Chasers Podcast. We will see you guys next week. And until then, we'll catch you later. Peace.
Sayonara, you lovely so-and-sos.